This is The Natural Laboratory, a podcast exploring science for Bay Area National Parks. I'm Daniel Strain. In the second part of this series on the Tomales Bay watershed, we'll explore wetland restoration projects here on the Point Reyes Peninsula and across California. These 8th grade students are getting a soggy introduction to estuary food webs in the Giacomini wetlands at the southern tip of Tomales Bay. They sort through buckets of muddy water, plucking out lentil-sized bugs called water boatmen and crustaceans called amphipods. The animals seem plentiful now, but 10 years ago, cows, not crustaceans, would have held sway here. I'm talking with Lorraine Parsons, a wetlands ecologist with Point Reyes National Seashore, at the site of the old Giacomini Ranch.
The ranch was actually originally like a historic tidal marsh.
Streams like Lagunitas Creek dumped into a wide sandbank just to our west. But she says in the 1940s, as dairy ranches in Point Reyes flourished with government support, that land dried up.
The Giacomini family came in and actually levied a portion of that deltaic marsh and started doing a whole bunch of improvements to make it better foraging for dairy cattle.
Parsons is in charge of returning this ranch to its marshy past. In 2008, she watched as bulldozers took down the levees. Today, she says she's stunned at how quickly the ocean went to work.
We said 10 to 20 years to get areas that had like a salt marsh community that resembles kind of reference or natural marshes, and we're already beginning to see that now.
Some of these changes aren't easy to spot. Since restoration, pollution levels have dropped at the mouths of waterways like Lagunitas and Tomasini Creeks. Parson credits in part the booming grass and reed populations, which siphon off incoming pollutants like bacteria and ammonia. Still, the most prominent signs of marsh resurgence here are the abundant animal communities. As the 8th graders learn, the amphipods and bugs in their buckets are important food for bigger creatures.
When we came here, actually when the tides started coming up and you guys were eating lunch, there were like hundreds, I don't know, maybe thousands of shorebirds that flew in to the edges of the high water there.
Flocks like these are a boon for bird watchers, but they're also the sign of a healthy wetland, says John Takekawa. He's a wildlife biologist for the U.S. Geological Survey at the San Francisco Bay Estuary Field Station.
Go down and dig in the dirt and you'll be able to find out how many invertebrates there might be compared to what there used to be. But the birds respond to these invertebrates, so they're a much more visible sign of progress.
Every year, shorebirds like ducks and egrets make the long journey from Canada and Alaska to as far south as Central America, then back again. They depend on wetlands for food and rest as they go.
If you don't have the places in between, it's very difficult for birds to sustain this migration pathway.
Tomales Bay and San Francisco Bay to the south are booming pit stops for migratory birds. But not all seashores have done so well. According to some estimates, a host of impacts, most notably urban and agricultural development, have laid waste to more than half the wetlands in the continental U.S. alone.
The difference between San Francisco Bay and if you ever visit places like Hong Kong Harbor is that many of the places across the world are just water adjacent to concrete.
Takekawa and dozens of other scientists and conservationists launched the South Bay Salt Pond Restoration Project in 2003. They're aiming to restore thousands of acres of wetlands across San Francisco Bay. If the project succeeds, it will be one of the biggest restorations of its kind. And like the Giacomini wetlands, these new estuaries will stand as models for coastal communities worldwide.
What we've been able to do and our conservation community has been able to protect, I believe that that is something that makes the U.S. unique and also makes it a leader.
Guys, work hard. You only have about 15 minutes.
Today, these students are seeing that a healthy wetland depends on dozens of species, from grasses to shrimp and birds. It doesn't look like they'll run out of slimy critters to dig up. For the Pacific Coast Science and Learning Center, I'm Daniel Strain.